Thank you. Welcome, everyone. As said, a direct reason for this academy is that we have launched a new training course. Quick word about our trainings. You can find these on our website and in the manager. We have trainings for the online manager, for the KP manager, and for scripting. From the beginning, we planned also a training for DAs. We put that off a bit because when we started developing this training course about 2 years ago, there really wasn't that much content for DAs. They basically configured the passwords and that was it. And we did not thought that that was enough content to justify a training program. And we also knew at that point already that we were adding more features to survey access, and that at some point that would mean that there would be enough content for the training course. That moment is now. So we have created, this course, and it has been published. In this academy, I will briefly go over some of the other things that a DA is supposed to do, but I will mainly focus on the on the access features that we have added over the last year. So let's actually take a look at the agenda. Very briefly talk about what is a DA and what the responsibilities of the DA were. Then I have a part which I call resources, which is where I basically point you to all the things we have already published earlier about the responsibilities of the DA, so we can focus this academy completely on actually managing the access to your domain and surveys, because this is where we have added new features over the last year, and probably some of this is new for you. Not the longest academy that we will run, will take about 30 minutes, I think. So what is a DA? Now, very obvious, a user that has been granted DA rights is a DA. That sounds pretty obvious, but there is a reason why I emphasize this here. It means that you decide who is a DA, not Nipo. You create the users and you grant such a user a DA right or not. And I know that in the past, some of you have granted a lot of users DA rights simply because that is convenient. That is probably something, if you want to use survey groups, that you have to start rethinking, because as we will see later, there are consequences for those survey groups for DAs which are probably not wanted in day-to-day use. So you probably will need, if you start using survey groups, will need to take a look who in your domain has DA rights and if they really need them. We'll talk about that later. Other point that I would like to make here, that you should not confuse a DA user with the user named DA. The user named DA is the only standard or system user that that Enfield has. This is the user we create, we Nipo create. That is the user that we sent you the credentials of when you start using the domain, and you are supposed to use this user to create new users. And then once you have done that, you should store the credentials of the DA somewhere in a vault and not use them. And then only use that DA if some disaster happens and you lose all the other accounts. You can no longer log in to your domain, at least not with any user that has been granted DA rights. And then you can use that DA account to restore the access to your account. Again, we will see in a few slides that there is also a new reason why you should not use this user named DA in your day-to-day usage of Enfield. So, what then are the responsibilities of a DA? One we already talked about, to grant users access to the domain. Another one is to configure the domain for your users, make sure that your users can use their your domain in the most optimal way, and make sure that the usage of your domain is within the Enfield acceptable use policy. Let's take a more detail about these responsibilities. In the next slides, we'll go to them in reverse order. So make sure the usage of your domain is within the Enfield acceptable use policy. We have run a complete academy on this particular part, that is Enfield housekeeping. I took a look at this academy earlier this week. This is still completely valid. So if you are unsure what this exactly means and what features we have created to make it easy for you to keep these acceptable use policy, please watch this academy. In this academy, I also promised you a academy on metrics, survey metrics, because that is one of the other things that a DA is supposed to take an eye, is supposed to be aware of. We at that moment had that academy planned for late Q1 2020, but as we all know, something else happened at that point, and this fell to the cracks. We will run that metrics academy later this year. Other responsibility of your domain, configure the domain for your users, which basically means make sure that all the defaults are correct, that the password settings, like if a password should be expired or how long a password is valid, translations for buttons, redirect links, all of that. Configure the defaults for these settings. For this, I will simply point you to our new scripting course, which you can find in the Knowledge Center in the Enfield Manager. You go to courses, and there you will find the Enfield Domain Administrator course, and that has a complete explanation of what those defaults are, where you can find them. I think it has little added value if I now go over these here. So with that, we're going to spend our time, the rest of the remaining time of this academy, on the actual new features that we have added. And those all have to do with how you can grant user access to your domain or your surveys. Three things. We have added one is the SSO, the single sign-on. We have added a two-factor authentication, and we have created survey groups. And with these survey groups, it is actually possible to match users to surveys and then make sure that those users only can work on the surveys they should work on and don't and can't work or don't even see any other surveys. Let's start with a single sign-on. What is a single sign-on? A single sign-on basically means that you have one point where you authenticate yourself. And once you have done that, that authentication is then used by different other applications. So you only have to log in once, and that actually locks you in a lot of other applications. A example of this would be Office, that actually locks you in once, and then you are and then you have access not only to everything in the Office suite, which are a whole range of applications. We have made it possible to use such a single sign-on on Enfield as well, that it could actually be your Microsoft account that you then use to authenticate yourself in Enfield as well. There is one there's one customer at this moment that uses this, that is Kantar. Kantar has a very particular use case for this. Kantar has an awful lot of different domains and they are using this. So people authenticate themselves once, and from that point onwards, it is determined to which domains these people, those users actually have access. If you think, well, let's first say, if you are a member of the Kantar organization and you have any questions about how this single sign-on works for you, direct your questions to the Kantar help desk, which is Freshdesk. I can't answer these questions because Nipo doesn't own this part. If you are non-Kantar and you think, well, that single sign-on, that sounds like a cool idea, contact our help desk and we will see the Nipo help desk and we will see if and how this could work for you. One last thing, because we have a single sign-on, it also means that we have now two types of users within Enfield. Users that actually have been created within Enfield, we call those local users, and users that emanate from a directory not kept within Enfield, we call those global users. At least that is what we call them in the interface. If you look in the API, you will see that in the API, those users are actually called native users and directory users. In the documentation, we follow the terms that are used in the interface, so local and global. That's also what I will use in this academy. Any questions about the single sign-on, Art?
No. Sorry, okay. No questions so far.
Then I will proceed to the next one, which is the two-factor authentication. What is a two-factor authentication? Basically, if you are normally, that's the authentication we all know, is a password, you type in a password, and you are granted access to the application. What a two-factor authentication, as it says, you add a second factor in this. You not only type in your password, but you also have to type in a code that is generated on a device you own. So that helps protecting the system, because that means that people do not only have to know the password, they also have to have that device, and otherwise they can't get it. Let me give you a short demo on how this actually works. So let me go to one of my domains. I will go to my American domain, because that is the domain where I actually configured that two-factor authentication. So I will log in with that domain, not with a DA. I need to start with my password, and then the two-factor authentication will kick in, and it means, okay, you now need to enter a code, and that code I get by opening a authenticator app on my telephone, then selecting the account that I'm using, which is the Enfield domain America for Frank, and that then gives me a code which is valid for 30 seconds. This code, and voila, I'm in. So this is how this two-factor authentication works. This is a regular user, so we can take a quick look at what a regular user sees, and you see a regular user can look at the surface. There are a lot of things that you as a DA have here that a regular user does not have access to. That includes the configuration of the two-factor authentication. So let's sign out for this one, and let's log in as SADA to see how that part works. And again, I have to use the two-factor authentication because this is a different account. So I now have to select from the American domain my DA account. And that gives me 358478 as code. And there. And there I also now have the DA privileges, which have to do with access, interviews, and management. How to configure this? You do that here in settings, the domain settings, and here with the password settings at the bottom of this, you will find the setting enforced two-factor authentication. You simply check this, and that is all that you need to do. That two-factor authentication will then be turned on within 30 minutes. That also means be careful turning this on. So that actually means that from that moment on, when your users connect to your domain, they have to use that two-factor authentication, which means they need to configure a app. You probably want to give your users a heads up before turning this on. What happens if a user logs on the first time when you have enforced the two-factor authentication? That log on will tell them that two-factor authentication has been turned on and that they need to configure a app. They need to download a authenticator app. We suggest Microsoft or Google because those are the two that we test with. They need to download that on their telephone or another mobile device. They have a QR code in screen, so they need to scan that. They need to scan that QR code once they have downloaded that app, and that will then take care and make sure that the device is connected with this account. It's pretty straightforward. I've done this a Tuesday, and it took me all but 4 minutes to turn this on and configure my accounts to use this. One last thing to take a look at. What if someone, if your user loses his device, or simply less dramatic, gets a new device? That means that the two-factor authentication of that user needs to be reset. And you do that at the same place where you reset passwords. So you go to the user. Let's go to regular Frank user. And here we have reset password, but also reset two-factor configuration. And that simply means if you click this one, that then the next time this user logs on to the system, he needs to reconfigure that two-factor authentication. Okay, then one last thing that I wanted to show here. Remember, we said we have a new reason why you should not use the user named DI anymore for your day-to-day work. And here it is. If I use this user and log on, as you see, there is no two-factor authentication for this user. This user is exempt from the two-factor authentication. That makes sense because you are supposed to use this user to restore access to your domain if all other access have been lost. So it makes sense that this user is exempt from the two-factor authentication. It also means that you should not use this user for your day-to-day work because that more or less degrades your security. Okay, let's return to the presentation. Any questions about two-factor authentication, Art?
Yes, Frank. Okay. Is it possible to use two-factor authentication in combination with single sign-on?
The single sign-on takes care of the authentication. So that authentication is then run by that single sign-on and no longer by Enfield. You can combine single sign-on and local accounts. So you can turn that on for the local accounts, but the single sign-on, that means that whatever is responsible for that single sign-on, that actually takes care of the authentication. Then for the single sign-on users, not for the local users that you have created. So for that local users, you can still turn it on.
Okay, thank you. Those were the questions.
Okay, so that was the two-factor authentication. Now let's take a look at the survey groups. As mentioned, the survey groups, well, they're not new. They have been part of Enfield for more than a year now. They, for a large part, they are hidden because you need the API to configure these survey groups. We are slowly but surely moving this to also the interface, so to the actual manager. But not everything has been moved to the manager yet, so you still need to use for a large part the API to configure some of these things. Now, what are these survey groups? These survey groups can be used to match users to surveys and make sure that users only see the surveys they actually have business with and nothing else. Things to consider for the survey groups. Let's go over them. They can be configured for both local and global users. So both the local and global users can use these survey groups. They should be configured. They should be configured using the API. This means that you need to use the API to create your survey groups, and you need to use the API to assign your users to survey groups. Until a few weeks ago, you also needed to use the API to assign surveys to a survey group, but that is no longer needed. I will demo that later. That is one of the things that we now have moved to the interface. And surveys need to be assigned to a survey group. That makes sense because otherwise it doesn't. They can match. Users need to be assigned to a survey group for the same reasons. Users can be assigned to multiple survey groups, but a survey can only be assigned to one survey group. Now, scheme to see what that then would actually mean. In the scheme, I have created three survey groups, A, B, and C. The first four surveys are assigned to survey group A. And that means that, for instance, user B, who is only assigned to this survey group, can see and work on these four surveys, but this user will not see these surveys because they have been assigned to another survey group and user B is not a member of that survey group. We look at user C. User C is assigned to both A and B. So user C can see these 11 surveys because these 11 surveys belong to a survey group he has been assigned to. He will not see the last four surveys because these belong to C and he is not assigned to C. So, a schematic to show you what the survey groups do. Let's actually do a demo and drive home some of these points. I will go to my domain again. I will log out of this domain, sign out of this domain. I have configured an example, not on my American domain, but on my Asia Pacific domain. On this domain, I have created two survey groups, one Coca-Cola, one Pepsi-Cola. I have created five users that are assigned to any of these survey groups. Let's take a look at that. So let's start with a regular user, which this user has not been assigned to any of the survey groups that I've created. So this user has not been assigned to Coca-Cola. This user has not been assigned to Pepsi-Cola. This user is assigned to the default survey group. That is the survey group that any user has been assigned to when you create them. That user is then assigned to the default survey group. And that is the only group that this user has been assigned to. So let's see what that means. If we take a look at the surveys this user sees and said this is a regular user. He sees all the default surveys on this domain. He doesn't see any of the Coca-Cola or the Pepsi surveys, because these do not belong to the default group. These belong to either the Coca-Cola or the Pepsi survey groups, and this user does not belong to any of those groups. So, what then should we see if we start with a user that belongs to the Coca-Cola group, which is Joe CC? So this user belongs to the Coca-Cola group and only the Coca-Cola survey group. And as you see, he sees the two Coca-Cola surveys. He doesn't see any other survey because he does not belong anymore. He does not belong to the Pepsi Cola, to the Pepsi group, and he does not belong to the survey, to the default group either. So this is the only two surveys that he will see, the two surveys that are part of the Coca-Cola survey group. If this user then creates a new survey, let's do that. Let's call it new Coca-Cola survey. That's it. I can create that. I can create the survey. And as I said earlier, what we have added is that it used to be so until a few weeks ago that if you created a survey, that survey was then created in the default group. And then you needed to go into the API to then assign that survey into its correct group. Now, when a user creates a survey, it is created in the group that this survey belongs to, that this user belongs to, sorry. And in this case, this user belongs to the Coca-Cola group. So this survey has been created in the Coca-Cola group, a reason why he still sees it. We will see shortly what happens if you are a member of more than one group and you create a survey. So this is the Coca-Cola. Let's take a look at a user belonging to the Pepsi group and Pepsi Cola. That is one of the users belonging to the Pepsi group. And this user, again, doesn't see any of the default surveys because it's no longer a member, because this user no longer is a member of the default survey group. It's not a member of the Cola survey group, so it doesn't see those three Cola surveys. This user only sees the two Pepsi surveys, which is fine. Now, one last thing. What if we use a user that is assigned to both the Cola and the Coca-Cola and the Pepsi Cola survey? I need to look up how I called this user. Yeah, I called this user the Cola Director. Cola and Copa. Cola. And this user should then see all the Cola surveys. So the two Coca-Cola surveys that were already there, the two Pepsi Cola surveys, and the new Coca-Cola survey, because that has been created in the Cola group. So he sees this one too. This is a user belonging to more than one survey group. So let's see what happens if we create a survey while we are locked on as this survey. As you see, we have a choice now in which survey groups survey needs to be created. And the choice is between the two survey groups that this user is a member of. Okay, none. One real last thing to show. Remember in the beginning I said, if you are in the habit of granting DA privileges, not to people who are particular DAs, but just because it is convenient, you probably should stop you doing that if you want to use survey groups. Because what happens if I now log in as a DA on this domain? You see, I see everything. I see the default surveys. I also see those COLA surveys. And if you go to access and then actually look up this user, Frank DA, you can see this user only belongs to the default group, but that doesn't matter. This user is a domain administrator, and a domain administrator sees all surveys, which makes sense if you go back to what the responsibilities of a domain administrator are, that are to make sure that that this domain runs within the acceptable use policy, and therefore he needs to be able to see all surveys so he can locate any offending surveys. The domain administrator takes care of the global default, which also means that he needs to see all surveys to have an idea what a change in such a global default would actually mean for all the surveys. So if you want to use survey groups, please do no longer use domain administrators for your day-to-day work, because they will invalid your survey groups. Okay, that's a turn. Then, to sum up, users are created in the default group. You need to use the API to reassign those users to their correct group. I will not go over the exact API commands that you need to use for this. In the course, you will find a overview of all the API commands that you need to use for this. If needed, users need to be actively unassigned from the default group. Remember, users can belong to more than one group. So if you assign a user to the Coca-Cola group, it does not mean that he is unassigned from any other group that he is a member of. And default, he is a member of the default group. So if that is not needed, you need to actively unassign them from the default group. User can only create surveys in a group he is assigned to. We saw that. And as we also saw, a DA will be able to see and access all surveys, regardless of the survey group. Any questions?
Yes, Frank. Two questions came in. The first is it possible to grant access for a user to only one survey without using survey groups?
No. No, that means that you have to place that survey in a particular survey group of its own, and then grant that user access to that survey group. You can only limit access to surveys using survey groups.
Okay, thanks. The next question was, how do you create a survey group?
Except you use the API for this. And in the course, you will see which particular API commands you need to use for this. As said, we are slowly but surely moving this functionality into the manager as well. As I demoed, you can now assign at least surveys to a survey group already. That wasn't possible until a few weeks. When usage of this picks up, we will move more of these things into the manager. But for now, you should use the API to create survey groups.
Okay, thanks, Frank. Those are the questions.
Okay. Then final remarks already. Well, half an hour, so that is correct. Recording of the session will be available later this week. DA course is now available. I already showed you where you can find this in the manager. Next Academy session will be about KP sampling points. Those of you present that were present in the previous Academy probably remember that we promised at that point that this would be the next Academy, but we found an issue in assigning sample points, an issue already present in the old manager, and we said, okay, let's solve this first and also solve it in the new manager before rolling this out. So we flipped the two Academies and decided to have this one first and then the KP sampling points. That will now be early April. And then we'll have the survey metrics that we already promised a year ago. That probably will be May. Any last questions?
Yeah, well, one question came in, but that's best discussed outside of this session. So no, okay. No further questions.
Perfect. Then thank you for joining. And talk to you next time about the KP sampling points. Bye-bye.